Marley Marl, he had no problems finding records when he first stumbled across sampling.
Ah, since I worked at BLS, Mr. Hal Jackson, who had been playing soul records since the beginning, has a very great extensive library. And I used to just borrow certain records. You gotta think about it, WBLS, only black-owned station in hip-hop, R&B in New York since the 60s, so they had to have all of those records.
Was you ever going out looking for records, though?
Nah, I never had to, I'm telling you. I had WBLS library. Everything everybody was trying to find, they had. A lot of the records, I never even read the titles. If it had the groove and it felt nice and it was sampleable or whatever, boop, put the needle on it, boop, get the groove. I might put the record down and never pick it up again, not even read the title.
For everyone else, the only way to find good samples is to dig. That means going anywhere that sells records and flicking through hundreds of them in hope you might find that one little gem that makes you that big hit record.
You're welcome to the world of the vinyl dogs.
Hey!
My name's Tom Spencer and I work at Mr. Bongo's in London. Each country's got its different records that you can get. I mean, if you go to the States, you can go to flea markets, you can go to secondhand shops and buy ridiculously cheap break records that you'd never find in England. Whereas they come to England and they find stuff they can't get, like the Top of the Pops albums. And you might laugh at those when you see them in charity shops, but people be known to spend maybe $20 on a Top of the Pops album because you can't get them in the States.
I'll just go wherever, I'll pick up whatever record, I don't care. So, you know, to the lady, little old lady, little man selling his records for a couple of dollars, it's worth more, you know, to me at the end.
You can make good music out of rubbish records. Yeah, a lot of it's to do with having a good ear and having an imagination. You don't have to have a £100 record, obscure record of Norwegian jazz or anything. You know, you can do it with your Ray Conniff records if you want to.
One, two, one, two. My man, my mellow.
But not all producers will dig for their beats. You won't hear them talking about it much because it doesn't do much for their credibility. But with little time and a lot of money on their hands, they're happy to pay beat traders and record dealers for a record they can sample. Even better, if the record's that rare, they mightn't even have to pay for sample clearance or even publishing rights.
You can find yourself paying hundreds and hundreds of pounds for these obscure records with very little sampling material on them. But, you know, if you're a producer from New York, for example, and you're getting paid $10,000 for a remix, you know, it's worth you paying out £500 for that album if that's going to give you the drum beat that really stands you out from the rest of the records that are out that month, that week, you know, that year.
My name's Marco Shornish and I'm a record dealer. It's generally word of mouth with me. I don't advertise anywhere. People come to me if they want something to add to a track. African music, a lot of breaks coming from African records these days, a lot of Polish jazz, a lot of Czechoslovakian jazz. It's from those kind of records that some of the most precious recent beat discoveries have come from.
The UK have really been leaders, I think, because what they've done is tapped into the old Music the Wolf record libraries, which for great drum breaks, they're very obscure, very hard to find. And so, yeah, the UK producers, they've sampled them, they're keeping the best ones for themselves, and then selling all the remaining OK or half-good breaks to these American producers who come over, making sort of huge profits on them. It's quite funny.
Somebody like Pete Rock, someone comes to him and says, look, I've got this hot record, puts it on. Somebody who's been in the game long enough, like Pete, would know that this person's not trying to sell them some common record that they could go out. If it was, they wouldn't have gotten that far in the relationship with the person anyway.
What's up, y'all? Babu, Dilated, Beat Junkies. It happens everywhere, and it's not something that you can fight. You just, I mean, you have to be out there and be digging, but be aware that there's people out there whose their full-time mission is not making beats, but their full-time mission is to buy records and resell them.
Although it would be nice to think that all producers dig for their records, it's kind of accepted that a lot of producers don't do it. What is harder to accept is the stories you hear of producers who steal other people's beats. It's what we call in the hip-hop world, beat biting.
If you send out your beat tape, right now it's the digital era, Pro Tools. Come on, all somebody got to do is put your CD in Pro Tools. Bow, they got two tracks of it. They could just track it, make a record.
People, whether they take your sample or they just get an idea from it, I don't care who it is, whether it's me, yourself, anyone, they always get an idea from your beat tape. They'll hear something and say, oh, I'm gonna go home and do this and that.
It seems to be widely accepted that a certain amount of ripping off goes on in hip-hop. Maybe that's because hip-hop producers always have sample clearance to worry about. It's turned hip-hop into a game of who can get away with what.
I know you're gonna dig this.
You're dabbling in a business where you're technically stealing things. If you're an artist, you need to go buy paint, and you need that color for your painting. It's the same deal when you're making music. You're using music, you're paying a fee, but then there's that element that you might get a call, you know, and it's kind of unfair because you need these things to make what you're doing.
But just like everything else in hip-hop, there are certain ways to get around sample clearance.
I'm David Holmes.
I'm constantly sampling, but by the time I'm finished with it, you wouldn't recognize it, you know? I think that's the key, to sort of take something and then just make it your own. I don't mind clearing if it's pretty blatant. But if it's not blatant, you just keep your mouth shut and say nothing because it can never be proven.
What it's done is made people more creative now. So after the whole affair with Bismarcky getting sued and a number of other people getting sued, and then you've also got like people who've actually owned the rights to a lot of these funk records, and suddenly 10 years down the line, they come out of the woodwork and say, I own Impeach the President by the Honey Drippers. And you've sampled me on this record, this record, this record. You know, people have learnt now that you cannot get away with it. But there's also a different level. If you sample something and your record sales are maybe not even reaching 5,000, then you're a minor concern for a major label or a group who's made that original record. If your record sales are charting very highly and you're selling hundreds of thousands of units, then there's some money to be made.
There's been times where I've found stuff or heard about stuff that was on the radio and it was getting played, and I've had to personally be careful with that information because I don't want the people to get sued. There's people out there listening, you know, and I've known some people that had to pay money and got in trouble and all kinds of stuff, when it's really not fair, because when you put the track next to the original, it's night and day.
You could get away with samples so easy right now. I could take a bullshit lame sample. I could stretch the sample to any speed I want it to be. I could pitch it to any key I want it to be emotionally. You could manipulate samples right now. Nobody will ever know where it came from. Never.
Some people could say it's cheating.
Well, it is cheating, but I look at it like this. You could take any sample and pitch it into the emotion and the speed that you want it to be in. That's creativity right there, too. Not unless it's just that hot, like... You know what I'm saying? Not unless it's just so hot like that. It's drunken hot. And you know, that note and that feel is just, that's drunken hot. That's hot. You don't need to change it. Just clear that.
A break sampling someone's material and stealing it, it's all good. There's nothing wrong with it, but you got to know that that's not yours and other people have access to that same thing, so you can't be mad when it pops up on someone else's record. If you really, really are trying to be original and want to secure that you're not going to hear anything you take, you need to bend it, you need to pitch it, you need to shape it, you need to mold it, you need to create it, make it your own. That way, you know, you can ensure that it's an original piece.
Whether it's record digging, beat trading, or even beat biting, the one place where it's all happening the most is the undisputed home of hip-hop, New York City.
The vibe that you get in New York somehow really resonates with the ethos of hip-hop, if you want to call it that. You know, the recycling of old records, the subject matter of the MCs. You know, that's where it all came from.
We're in Manhattan right now. I think as soon as you get into New York, you can feel the hip-hop here. Just the atmosphere, the way people dress. You can hear music coming out of cars, from shops. You can hear hip-hop on TV adverts, commercials, radio all day long. You live and breathe hip-hop here.
We're off to Sound Library Records right now, just passing through Times Square in the traffic. It's a bit of a bumpy ride, as you can hear my voice. Yeah, stop. There it is.
We're in Sound Library right now. Goodies everywhere. We've got a whole section here, must be at least 150 records there, just drums. So if you want to get the drums for your backing track, look no further. This is the drum break for Eminem, The Way I Am. That's the drum break on there. I don't want to say the name, obviously, but drums and that, even though you deny it heavily. Little Richard drum breaks, believe it or not. It's been sampled in at least 20, 30 hip-hop records.
This is a Tribal Quest break. I don't really want to say the name of it, but one of their big hit records. $18, that's quite cheap. We just come across a record here by the name Jack Bruce, sampled an early 90s hip-hop records by the dozen. Everybody sampled it. One artist in particular who sampled it. It's basically every track on their album. It's the bass line on his album.